Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Help for Writers, 210 Solutions to the Problems Every Writer Faces. Written and read by Roy Peter Clark. This audiobook is dedicated to my mother and first editor, Shirley Hope Marino Clark. Introduction: The 7 Steps of the Writing Process. Writing is not magic. It's a craft, a process, a set of steps. As with any process, things sometimes break down. Even in a good story, the writer runs into problems. So the act of writing always includes problem solving. At times, things get so bad, writers feel as if they're drowning. Before going under, they reach for a lifeline. This audiobook offers that lifeline. To hear some writers talk, you would think we have problems in the gajillions, from whether to use gajillion or gazillion, to whether that exclamation point after help is necessary. As I've grown in my own craft, I've listened to my brothers and sisters of the word and have developed a theory to focus this recording. Here it is, my theory of writer redemption. The big problems of writers are few in number and lend themselves to reliable solutions. I subscribe to the gospel of Donald Murray, one of America's most influential writing teachers, that writers across genres and disciplines share a similar process, a set of tactical steps. If you dig deep enough, you can discover that common method. Surely, you wonder, the sonneteer must develop a different approach to the craft than the pamphleteer. How about the author of a 140-character message on Twitter? Is her process the same as the novelist's? At the highest level of abstraction, my answer would be yes. So, what are those shared steps? Getting started. All writers need a kickstart, a starter's pistol, a spur to the flank, something that jolts them into action. This recurring need leads them to explore the world and their own experiences for writing ideas. Such curiosity turns them into hunters and gatherers who collect the raw materials that render their reports and stories interesting and significant. Step 2, getting your act together. A writer who goes exploring can bring home so many treasures that the writing space and the writer's mind can become cluttered. Writers must be able to find what they need when they need it. At this stage, it is too early to know whether an author has what she needs to fill a novel or memoir or annual report with interesting and important ideas, facts, and language. Step 3. Finding focus. Each piece of writing benefits from a focus, a guiding idea, a scene, or an emotion that communicates to writer and reader what the work is really about. A telegram, Twitter post, or haiku needs a focus, but so does a short story, a love note, or a complaint about your plumber to the Better Business Bureau. Such a unifying notion helps the writer select the best collected material, the best characters, the best details, the most important points, down to the best word and the best mark of punctuation. A focus will help the writer craft an opening sentence or paragraph. And sometimes writing that paragraph is required to find a focus. It's the yin-yang of the writing process. Step 4, looking for language. The Old English poets were said to have a word hoard from which they could choose the best language to shape their poems. How great it would be to throw open a closet door and find just the right word for just the right writing task. Where do such words come from? They come from a life of reading and study of the craft, from the daily experiences of language, from travel, from dictionaries, and from the research required to gather not just raw data, but the ideas, images, and keywords necessary to understand a group of people or a field of study. Step 5, building a draft. It is never easy to know when it's time to sit down at your keyboard to create a first draft. The writer often feels resistance at this stage, expressed as writer's block or procrastination. The writing will begin to flow if the writer has attended to the earlier steps. W.H. Auden once described a poem as a, quote, verbal contraption with a person, a guiding intelligence hiding inside. All texts are constructed, often from a blueprint or plan, erecting an architecture of meaning and purpose. The writer must decide on a sequence, what goes first in a work and what goes last. A haiku has 3 lines. A legal brief builds an argument. Shakespeare wrote plays in 5 acts and sonnets in 14 lines. Each part of the work carries a special power, magnified when the writer creates an effective structure for the whole. Step 6, assessing your progress. When writers talk to teachers or editors, they often blurt blurry language to mask the one key question that concerns them, which is, how am I doing? As a coach, my version of that question as I approach a writer is, how is it going? Everyone wants a progress report, calibrated against different goals and criteria. The writer makes preliminary judgments about the current quality of the work and how much time and energy are left to improve it. The writer can reach conclusions on his own, but often benefits from an intervention. When Donald Murray was asked how the day's writing had gone, he had 2 reliable answers, both framed in the affirmative. He could respond by quantity. I produced 10 pages before lunch, or if necessary, by quality. I wrote 1 really great sentence this morning. Step 7, making it better. Completing a draft of a text can be such hard work that the writer may be charmed by the illusion that the job is almost finished. But the process does not stop there. The final problem for the writer is how and what to revise, what to delete, what to insert. It is during revision that the writer will refine, polish, and perfect a work that can never be perfect, but can grow and become good enough to fulfill the writer's purpose. Key to a successful endgame is to leave time and energy for revision, the way a long-distance runner saves energy for a sprint to the finish line. Let's review those 7 steps. Get started, get your act together, find focus, look for language, build a draft, assess your progress, make it better. If those 7 phrases represent the writer's largest and most imposing tasks, the effort to complete them can be stymied by a set of pesky problems. Those problems have influenced the structure of this audio program, Help. Each chapter begins with an explanation of one stage of the writing process. At each stage, you will encounter 3 of the most persistent and difficult obstacles to completing that task, a total of 21 common writing problems. For each problem, I offer 10 practical and proven solutions drawn from the work and life stories of successful writers, living and dead. Do the math, even you English majors listening, and realize that you own the 210 writing solutions promised in the title, enough lifelines to survive a mudslide of deadlines. How to get help. Feel free to think of Help for Writers as an owner's manual for your writing process. When I bought my 2002 Chrysler PT Cruiser, my first job was to read the owner's manual from beginning to end just to get the lay of the automotive land. I don't remember consulting it again until the evening a neighbor knocked to alert me that my dome light was on, draining my battery. I tried the usual fixes, flicking switches, checking fuses, slamming doors. Nothing worked. I was stuck. What could I do?
"Why don't you consult the owner's manual?" said my wife, with grumpy disdain.
All writers live for those days when the work speeds along the highway on cruise control, when the author's only tasks are to point the hood ornament toward the destination and steer. But then there are those days when you can't get started, or you can't find something you need amid all your clutter, or you can't decide what to include and what to leave out, or you think your last paragraph should be your first, or you begin to wonder why you became a writer in the first place. You realize you need help. In fact, you realize you need help! This recording offers a roadmap to get you through your writing process, a travel guide that takes you from the exploration of story ideas to the final choices of revision. But it would be a mistake to think of writing as a straight and narrow road, or this recording as some program of recovery for drunken drivers that must be followed one step after another. The writing process more resembles a twisting mountain roadway where solutions for your next problem can be found back a few miles. For that reason, we have built into Help a certain amount of strategic repetition. You'll discover, for example, that the idea of setting an early artificial deadline works at almost every stage of the process through research, planning, drafting, and revision. It should be a comfort for you to learn that the problems of writers and drivers are predictable and manageable. So click on your seatbelt, turn the ignition key, turn up the volume, let's get started, enjoy the ride. Step 1. Getting started. Having the urge to write is one thing, acting on it another. At the age of 15, I broke my ankle during a baseball game, and I still remember how I planned my first week of recovery. I would write a spy novel. It was the era of Goldfinger and Thunderball, and I dreamed of creating my own version of Super Spy 007. I was a good and clever writer as a teenager, but had written nothing longer than a short story or a book report. No matter. I was ready to go. I found a comfortable spot on the back porch, rested my bum leg on a cushion, grabbed a legal pad and ballpoint pen, and then click, 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 nothing. I have a clear memory of what stopped me from getting started. I did not know how to write a novel. I knew what a novel looked like, but not the process needed to create one. I thought I could write a book just by milking my imagination. After all, it was fiction. I could invent stuff. But it soon became clear that I needed to know more, a lot more, about spies, about Russians, about gadgets, about women, about everything, before I could proceed. Then the doubts arrived. What made you think you could write a novel? You're not a writer. You're just a clumsy little asshole. You can't even slide into home plate without breaking an ankle. Then, of course, the temptations followed. Roy, the Yankees game is on. Want to come in and watch it? Or, hey, kid, want to go to Carvel for some ice cream? Or, hey, Roy, Rosie's on the phone for you. We learn in science class that inertia is a physical force that manifests itself in two ways. Things that are still, not moving, will stay still until acted upon by outside forces. My laptop will remain on my desk until I pick it up and fling it, discus style, out the window. But inertia also describes the way an object in motion stays in motion until some external force slows or stops it. For the purposes of writing, I call the first kind bad inertia because it describes inactive writers who can't get moving. The other kind is good inertia because once you get started, you can keep things rolling. No writing creates no writing. Some writing creates more writing. Getting started requires forms of exploration that become a way of life. The writer is a curious person who discovers topics to write about and, over time, comes to see the world as a storehouse of story ideas. Just as Rex, my little terrier, goes out into the yard to sniff for possums, so the writer is ignited by the hint of something in the air, a thought, a theory, an emotion, a meme, a story, a character worth attention, a problem to be solved. The problems covered in this chapter include no ideas, bad assignments, and trouble with the research. No ideas. The first challenge is to find something to write about. In my experience, there are two basic types of writers, the ones who write only in response to assignments and those who find ways to work on their own story ideas. Writers need both modes to fulfill the demands of the craft, but the best writers follow their nose along the path to good stories. They generate many more ideas than can be put into practice. That's a nice problem to have. No writer should descend into a welfare system provided by editors or teachers or bosses. The writer wants and needs the ability to work independently. That means coming up with your own ideas and arguing diplomatically that your ideas have the best juice. Then there's bad assignments. There are no bad story ideas or bad story assignments. What turns out to be good or bad is what the writer does with the idea or assignment. The assignment is a starting point. Editors or teachers may disagree, especially those who insist on adding stipulations for its execution. You've got to cover the meeting, get responses from each member of the city council, 3 reactions from people who live on the north side of town, 3 from the south side, yada, yada, yada. In such cases, the writer feels like a short order cook. With enough freedom, the writer explores the assignment for the elements that will be most interesting and most important, being alert to those sudden moments of clarity when even a bad assignment becomes a nifty story. Then there's trouble with research. If your goal is to write a book, research may take years or even decades. Or if an emergency call comes in and you must verify whether the fire destroyed the friary or the nunnery, it can take 5 minutes. Writers make the mistake of thinking of writing and research as mutually exclusive tasks. Since the research usually comes first, it can grow bigger and bigger, feeding on time that could be spent on drafting and revision. A reliable strategy is to write early and often, even if just a note on the results of the day's research. Writing about your research will help you determine whether you know enough to write at full speed or need to learn much more. Problem number one, I can't think of anything to write. Solutions. Spend a morning in the bagel shop or an afternoon in a bookstore. For the price of a cup of coffee and a bagel, you can listen in on the morning's conversations about news and current events, or you can browse through new books and magazines at a favorite bookstore. A survey will generate an endless stream of story ideas. Any cafe or bookstore is a story idea machine. I just spent 20 minutes with the magazines displayed in the library of the Poynter Institute, the school where I've taught writing for more than 30 years. Even with our focus on journalism, I found an array of topics in the cover stories alone, gaining an overview of the broad concerns of the day. In April 2010, these included healthcare reform, how to survive in a bad economy, the influence of the iPad and other reading tablets, attempts to deal with childhood obesity, the beginning of the baseball season, the Tiger Woods sex scandal. Within this forest of large issues, there are interesting little stories hiding behind the trees. For example, I'm thinking of writing a comparison of the Apple iPad with the old kid's toy Etch-a-Sketch. My eyes found the cover of Publishers Weekly, which included this tease, quote, "Dystopian future is here. Teens are reading about vampires, but end-of-the-world scenarios are bigger than ever," unquote. A light flickered in my head. What I wondered is the relationship between vampire stories and narratives about the end of the world, and is there any link to the fact that we have begun calling some young people millennials? Suddenly, I'm off and running and writing. Keep a little notebook to compile story ideas. Ideas can be elusive, like fireflies at dusk. You will need a dozen story ideas for every one you eventually execute. You'll need a place to store them. Use whatever suits you, including the notes mode on your mobile phone. I prefer to go old school, a tiny notebook suitable for a pocket or purse. I know writers who need paper in their pockets, in their cars, on the toilet tank, on the table beside their beds. The eccentric artist Salvador Dali was known to take quick naps and awaken suddenly, his head filled with surrealistic images. He would capture these images on a pad as soon as possible so that they could not escape. Your notebook can contain fully articulated story ideas such as, sports journalists and the public are harsher in their criticism of women athletes who play aggressively to the point of violence than of male athletes. More often, you will record the seeds of story ideas, most of which will die out. A few will bear fruit. Here are examples of seedlings. Not one person played an April Fool's joke on me this year. Does the word dope, as in the Disney dwarf Dopey, derived from the slang word for drugs? It turned out the drug slang derives from the Dutch word for sauce or gravy. I saw 10 big alligators around the golf course. What's the rule for a ball that's in play but dangerously close to a gator? Dog leg to the left, gator jaws to the right. Church was packed for Easter Sunday Mass, but I saw only 3 Easter bonnets, all worn by little girls. Whither the bonnet? Read a book on a topic that is unfamiliar to you. Insomnia can be good for you. It was good for me one night. When, at about 3 a.m., I got up and turned on the television to see a C-SPAN panel featuring the work of Timothy Ferris, author of several important books on astronomy and cosmology. No, not cosmetology. That deals with craters on your skin. Ferris is more interested in craters on the moon, and one, about 100 miles wide, off the Mexican coast, possibly responsible for the extinction of many species on Earth, including the dinosaurs. See how much I've learned just by watching and then reading Ferris? You should always have a book going, advised Donald Murray, that comes from outside your normal field of interest. Because my interests are reading, writing, sports, religion, and language, my outside reading includes works on photography and the visual arts, philosophy, natural science, and applied mathematics. By reading such work, I discover not just specialized content, but also story ideas that span more than one field. You don't need to spend much money. New media technologies afford access to texts of all genres from all disciplines written over centuries of time. Through online bookstores alone, writers can read passages for free of books that are for sale. Research is not the primary purpose of such commercial enterprises, but they allow us to taste many books and articles, including the ones we eventually purchase. Break your routine. Go to work or school a different way. I am a creature of routine, especially when it comes to my personal life. I like to stay home and watch television on Friday nights. And I enjoy going to breakfast on Saturday morning at the Frog Pond restaurant, especially if they are serving strawberry waffles. That doesn't mean I have to drive to the restaurant the same way each week, and I try not to. There are probably 10 or more routes from my house to St. Pete Beach, and I've taken most of them. You may see stories from the vantage point of the main road, construction of a new big box store, which might bring more traffic and more congestion, but lower prices. A great offbeat story, on the other hand, is more likely to be found on a side street off the beaten path. An eagle sits atop a light pole, looking down at children playing soccer. An 80-year-old Catholic nun takes dance lessons from a former rockette. A charter school for poor kids offers golf lessons for PE. A corner of a cemetery is reserved for stillborn children. None of this is visible from the main road, so you must learn to turn left, turn right, and drive down that alley, even if it takes you a little longer to reach your destination. There are stories that come out of Wall Street and others that come out of Main Street, but don't get stuck in that false dichotomy. There are many stories to be found on the side streets, and especially, as Bruce Springsteen would tell you, on the back streets. Eat out. In the last couple of years, I have switched my lunch place of choice from Pizza Hut to the Banyan restaurant and coffee shop. Banyan is more stylish, but sits across the alley from Molly's, a rooming house and bar that features a laundromat and draft beer for a dollar. Negotiating the distance between those two unlikely neighbors, I'm sure I've run into dozens of story ideas, most of which I would never have encountered had I not abandoned my personal pan pizza routine. Francis X. Klein's, one of the finest writers in the history of the New York Times, once said that he knew he could find a good story if he could just get out of the office. With the virtual world at their fingertips, writers seem more office-bound than ever, achieving escape velocity from a mediated world to a flesh-and-blood one takes a concerted effort. When people eat, they also laugh, argue, canoodle, whisper, check each other out, check you out, or talk too loud. Enjoy your meal, but keep that mobile device in your pocket or purse and focus your attention on what is going on around you. Never be afraid to turn your listening into a conversation, especially with an interesting stranger. There are 8 million stories in the Naked City, said the narrator of the old television series. Even better, there are at least 3 or 4 in a local eatery. If you can just get out of the office, or off campus, or even down the street, the school or office cafeteria may crave your business, or you may prefer a peanut butter and jelly sandwich at your desk, but your physical liberation from such cloisters will lead you to a world of stories. Watch people in their natural habitats. My cousin Teresa was high up in the World Trade Center when the first plane hit the building on the morning of September 11, 2001. She hadn't had breakfast yet, so she was about to enjoy a muffin and a cup of coffee with her coworkers. They all felt the impact of the plane, and the whole building seemed to sway back and forth, a cart of fruit rolling first to the left, then to the right, and back to the left. She escaped with her life, but nothing would be the same for any of us. This may be the ultimate example of what screenwriter Robert McKee describes as an inciting incident, an event, small or large, that dramatically changes the nature of an ordinary day, that, quote, radically upsets the balance of forces in the protagonist's life. Anyone who has been in a car accident knows the feeling. Just another day of work, a routine drive down the service road or of a busy highway, and then wham! We have a cliche to describe such events. We say they hit us out of the blue. Before we can tell stories about these lightning strikes, we have to develop a keen sense of normal life. How were people acting in the bar and grill at the exact moment that the runaway car crashed through the picture window? One way to learn the narrative potential of normal experience is to hang out. Where? In a sense, it does not matter. Try the park, the mall, a busy street, the gym, a hotel lobby, a church, a concert hall, a pub, the airport, the bleachers of a high school football game, Dunkin' Donuts. Ride the bus, take the train. Even when you are stuck inside that human sardine can we call an airplane, take in the setting. Imagine that a scene will play out there. Watch people's reaction upon takeoff or when the first bump of turbulence strikes. Could you write a play from the dialogue between characters on that plane or a novel? Your body may just be hanging out in all these places, but your mind is on fire with curiosity, imagining characters, dialogue, narrative tension, points of view, a sequence of scenes, all the building blocks of story construction. Read posters, billboards, store signs, graffiti. Lane DeGregory, one of the most talented narrative writers in America, offers this advice to fledgling scribes. Let the walls talk. Drive around and look at the big signs, commercial and governmental. Walk around to see what the small signs say. When you enter a building or an office or someone's home, look at what they've hung up on the walls, or especially on the refrigerator door. In our house, that door will have a lot to say. You'll find newspaper clippings about our daughter's theatrical performances, the names of local businesses we support, magnets with the names of products or causes, funny stories or comic strips to which we relate, crucial telephone numbers, a recipe that signals an upcoming holiday feast. If you write fiction, you have many important scenic decisions to make, including What will the walls say about my character? I once shadowed a political writer, Howell Rains, to a barbecue in rural Florida, and we wandered through the parking lot looking at the bumper stickers. Howell wanted the car bumpers to talk to him about the political, religious, and cultural affiliations of those in attendance. "Let me know if you see any George Wallace for President signs," he coached me. If you were writing a story about me, you could learn a lot by letting my office walls and shelves talk. You would see a campaign poster from the 1930s of my grandfather, Peter Marino, who ran as a Republican for the New York State Assembly. Next to it, you can find his name as a 4-year-old boy on a ship's manifest from about 1900 that records his family's journey from Italy to the port of New York. You'll find a small black and white sports pennant with the name of my alma mater, Providence College. You'll find a photo of me as a young child typing on a toy typewriter. There is an artistic representation of my boyhood sports hero, Mickey Mantle, standing next to my mother's idol, Joe DiMaggio. 20 minutes in my office will have the walls not just talking, but shouting details about my family history and my values. Read the news for undeveloped story ideas. By now, all fans of TV's Law and Order understand that many of the storylines are ripped from the headlines. I guess when you've been on the air for so many years and spawned so many spinoffs, you better have a convenient way to generate plots. And what better place to find them than in the news? Begin with the small stories, the ones inside the paper. Look for announcements of events you might write about. Scour the classified ads in the paper and online. Check out the list of lost puppies. I remember well the day I noticed an announcement on the religion page of the newspaper that a young minister was going to spend the weekend on a platform atop a tall pole and preach the gospel to all who would listen. The item made me recall the story of a famous hermit from the early Christian church, Simeon Stylites, who lived and prayed and preached from atop a pillar. When I traveled to the city of Bradenton to interview the preacher, I noticed how many Protestant churches stood on the street where he worked, at least 6 or 7 as I recall. Then it struck me, these churches competed for congregants and their souls. Each needed a way to stand out, and what better way to stand out than from atop a pole, marketing the gospel from on high. Here is the first item in the Lost and Found column of today's classified ads. Lost, bird, cockatiel, gray with white face, St. Pete Beach area. Whistles at toes, heartbroken, and then the phone number. It took me 30 seconds to find the telephone number of a person who lives on the beach and is heartbroken because his cockatiel, who whistles at toes, is missing. So, what are you waiting for? Get to work. Dial that number. Interview the oldest person you know and the youngest. Many people are living longer and healthier lives. Someone who was born in 1919, like my mother, has experienced the Depression, World War II, the invention of the television, the fall of Soviet Russia, the election of an African-American president, and on and on. Such human sources are precious and fleeting. They provide testimony for oral histories, and they embody a set of experiences that can be mined for story ideas, both fiction and nonfiction. Tommy Carden died at the age of 81, but not before I had an opportunity to extract his memories of the invasion of Normandy, the Battle of the Bulge, and the liberation of Buchenwald concentration camp. A friend once referred to me as an anniversarist, and it's true. The recurring cycle of time, often expressed as an anniversary, offers opportunities to learn about the past and to see our history as a mirror of our own time and place. This audiobook, I just realized, is scheduled for release the month of the 10th anniversary of 9/11/2001. We are about to recognize in St. Petersburg the birth of Salvador Dali, who would have been 100 years old. By August, I will have been married 40 years to the same woman. Look for such anniversaries as an opportunity to find sources who lived through the original events. While wisdom, at least on occasion, comes with age, it can also come with youth, and even kids can become sources for story ideas. Like others of my age, I often ask practical advice from children on how to play a video game or how to put other technologies to work. I recently discovered that a 5-year-old boy named Donovan was an expert on all things Star Wars. He hit me in the knee with his version of a lightsaber and left a little mark. And my next-door neighbor, a 5-year-old girl named Charlie, stood in my driveway yesterday, turned, looked into where I was working, and said, "Wow, Mr. Clark, nice garage." Spend the day with a person whose job interests you. A classic example of an offbeat story idea was carried out by columnist and author Jimmy Breslin, who on the day of John F. Kennedy's burial at Arlington Cemetery in 1963, wrote a story about the grave digger. If you can't think of anything else to write, go spend a day with a grave digger. Jeff Klinkenberg has built his career as a Florida feature writer with an eye for eccentric characters performing quirky jobs. In 4 anthologies of his work, you can find a sponge diver, a plume hunter, a hog catcher, the original Coppertone girl, a highway patrolman, a fish smoker, a taxidermist, and a Holocaust survivor turned burlesque queen who now repairs roofs on apartments she owns. There may be no more reliable story form than a day in the life. The day part of this equation creates an immediate time element that places useful boundaries around the research and spins possible narrative lines for a story. And the life part allows the writer to see sources in their natural habitats, observing them in action rather than interviewing them in stasis. It also helps to find a person who works as close to the action as possible. The garbage truck driver, not the supervisor. The prostitute, not the madam. The gravedigger, not the cemetery director. Problem number 2. I hate writing assignments and other people's ideas. Solutions. Learn to turn an assignment into your story. This strategy may persuade you that the stories generated by your own ideas can be as good or as better than the stories that come from assignments. The reason is obvious. When we invest in something, we treasure it more. That is true, whether the investment is in a mortgage, which, by the way, once meant death oath, a marriage, or a common stock. You care more when it's your idea. When you care more, you try harder. You try harder to validate the reason you went after the story in the first place. From your view of the world, this is what matters. This idea is interesting and important. These feelings can have dangerous consequences. You cannot be a writer and believe that only your ideas are worthwhile. Talk with your editor, teacher, friend, or coworker. Find out what potential that person sees in the assignment. Holster your gun and proceed with a sincere desire to learn. But remember this, you are not on the job to dish out whatever greasy meal the boss orders. Good work requires you to test the assumptions built into any idea. The assignment may be to find out why there are so many auto accidents along Route 19, but your research may show that the statistics are skewed by trouble at one particular intersection. The assignment may have come from someone else, but you can turn it into your story. Treat assignments as story topics rather than story ideas. Remember that write something about Mother's Day is only a topic or occasion, not a full-grown story idea. The key choices remain with you, including whether to write about mothers, grandmothers, or great-grandmothers. You could write about the mother superior who works at the mother house. You could write, as Lane de Gregory did, about a frat house mother who had no children of her own. If you really want to go around the bend, write about the yo mama jokes used in humorous insult fights. One of the Ten Commandments orders us to honor our mothers. So what's up with your mama so stank, she makes right guard turn left and secret tell all? Writers take pleasure from finding an alternate route to a great story. One of my favorite opportunities arrived when the identity of the man who helped Woodward and Bernstein bring down Richard Nixon was finally revealed. For 30 years, we knew that mysterious person, W. Mark Felt, as Deep Throat, based on a famous pornographic movie from the early 1970s. It occurred to me that while the deep background source may have helped expose government secrets, it was the movie that would have the more sustained influence on American culture. The movie, I argued, led to the, quote, pornographication, unquote, of many aspects of our national identity. When all the other writers are looking at the stage, don't be afraid to turn around and watch the audience. Make it your own. This is one of the tired pieces of advice that TV judges give to contestants in talent shows such as American Idol. You did it just like the record, dog. You got to find a way to make it your own. Many high school graduations are written about in formulaic ways, but each ceremony has its special feel, and the attentive writer has the ability to capture that in the writing. At my daughter Lauren's graduation in 1999, a late afternoon Florida storm threatened to drown out the event, the wind knocking over portable chairs on the football field and sending mortarboards spinning across the campus like tumbleweeds. As the ceremony went on for an hour, then two, apocalyptic storm clouds shrouded the eastern sky and began to drift over the stadium. In a visually stunning juxtaposition, the western sky revealed a spectacular sunset with hints of a rainbow forming in the distance. These narrative details add value to a piece of writing. My story would have the important facts and details, of course, the number of graduates, the names of valedictorian and salutatorian.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.